So I want to define topology K theory for C star algebras. The K theory for C star algebra started with topological K theory. So first I'll do topological K theory. And so topological K theory is for any compact space, you have an abelian group Kx. So for every compact space, we will construct an abelian group Kx. Since compact Hausdorff spaces are in bijective correspondence with commutative C star algebras, these two are in bijection with each other by the JNS theorem, so Gelfand-Naimov theorem. So this group can be defined for commutative C star algebras also. So this group a priori will be defined using the topology on X, but without appealing to the topology on X, by only using the functions on X, we can define Kx. So this is defined for all commutative C star algebras, and this can be extended to non-commutative C star algebras also. And the theorem that extends this is called Say-Swan theorem. Okay, so for any topological space X, you can define Kx, and for any non-commutative C-star algebra also, for any C-star algebra, you can define K of A. So for any algebra, in fact, it can be any algebra. It does not have to be C-star algebra. Over complex numbers, you can define K0A. There are two groups, K0A and K1A. I won't have time to go to K1. I'll define only K0A. So what the Say-Swan theorem will say is, and that is what I'm going to prove, is K of X is naturally isomorphic with K0 of C of X. And then, if I have time, if M is a compact manifold, then K of M is isomorphic with K0 of Cm, that is that theorem, which is isomorphic to K0 of C infinity. So the K theory can be defined in terms of the smooth functions on M. You don't need to go to the continuous functions on M. Okay. So this is the plan. This is what I want to do. So let's start with the topological K theory part. And for that, I'll recall this lecture will be mostly on vector bundles. So I have to do vector bundles first, and then the K of X is defined using vector bundles. Okay. Vector bundle is, so X for us will throughout be a compact Hausdorff space. A vector bundle will consist of two things. So a vector bundle over X. So a vector bundle over X is a pair. E together with a projection with a surjection P. So what is P? So P is a surjection from E to X. Let me write it this way. P is a surjection. And the fibers, so for X in X, look at the inverse image over X. Inverse image over X, so let define EX to be P inverse of X. These inverse images has a vector space structure. So has a, it's a finite dimensional vector space structure. Okay, our vector spaces will be either over R or complex. Mostly it will be over complex. If the vector space is defined over R, then the bundle is called a real vector bundle. If it is defined over complex, it's called a complex vector bundle. Mostly it will be complex for us. And then the third crucial condition is the local triviality condition. That is, if you take a point X in X, so there exists an open set UX, X in UX open in X, such that over UX, if you look at the inverse image of UX, this will be isomorphic to a trivial bundle. So I'll explain what it means. So what this condition means is
X in UX.
NX, yeah, X in UX, that's what I was. UX open, X in UX, such that this happens. Okay, so first let's, P is a surjection, so E is just the union of all X in X, P inverse X. So it is union of X in X, EX. So over every point X in the base space, by the way this is called the base space and this is the total space, over every point X in the base space, there is a vector space associated to it over it, and it is finite dimensional. And this condition tells that they are patched together in a nice way. So what is this isomorphism means? It's so look at P inverse of UX. That should be isomorphic to UX cross CNX, first of all as topological spaces, such that this diagram commutes. What is pi 1? Pi 1 is the first projection. So if y is here, if y is here and e is, p of e is y, if e goes to y, it should commute. So the first coordinate of this e, so E will go to something like Y something, because it has to commute, right? So E has to go to something which comes back to Y, at the first coordinate. So it preserves, if Y is, it takes the fiber over E to the CNX, the finite dimensional space there. And that should be a linear isomorphism as well. So that is the, that is this condition. That is, over UX, it has to be a trivial bundle. These are called trivial bundles. And the isomorphism should be a topological isomorphism, first of all. Topologically, it should be a continuous map, inverse, continuous, and so on. And this diagram should commute, which means the fiber over any point y should go to y comma something. So that will and that should be a linear map as well. So if that is the case, we call E to be a vector bundle over X. So is this definition clear to everyone, or maybe I did not express it fully? So let's
goes to y comma blank.
Yeah, so it should be a
blank. What if you write T sub y or B?
And what is that isomorphism?
This thing
is
T sub y or B. E goes to y.
E, comma, yeah, I'm just looking for space. Y comma
T sub y of E.
Yes, and T.
Where
yeah.
T sub y
is a linear
map. P inverse y to C n is a linear isomorphism.
Yes, thanks. Should be a real. So, yeah, I was not expressing it very clearly. So, this diagram should commute. So, what this diagram commute means, if you take y, look at its inverse image, which is the fiber EY, which is the inverse image P inverse Y. So, if you look at E in P inverse Y, This should go to something, but which it has to come back to y itself, because that is the first projection. So the first coordinate has to be y. You name the second coordinate as tye, t of ye. Then the second coordinate will be a map from the p inverse from fiber to c and x. But this has a linear space structure, and that linear this map should be a linear map. So over every point there exists an isomorphism between P inverse UX. There exists a map from here to here, which satisfies these things, which is fiber wise linear, and it's an isomorphism.
What is that isomorphism?
There exists such an isomorphism.
P inverse V of X or UX. What is that space?
It's a collection of all UI. It is this.
It is subspace of the total vector space E. You say it is a homeomorphism from that subset, from that open set, to that other space U cross here.
How is the NX related to
C? NX will depend on X over every. So that is a dimension of EX over UX.
Okay, you might as well say assume it's
constant rank.
Yeah, correct.
Okay. It is locally constant, but he's okay. He's saying ask me to do it for constant things. Yeah, that's what I'm also going to do. So is that thing clear now? It's okay. So
why don't you draw a picture, just simple cylinder or something?
Okay. So R2 is a, let me give an example. So first, before that, let me make one remark. So this isomorphism tells you that EY is isomorphic to CNX. So the dimension of all the inverse images, P inverse, the dimension of all EY is constant locally. So that's the first remark. So if the dimension of all the fibers are constant throughout, we say it's a constant rank bundle, and the common dimension is called the rank of the bundle. So for then, there is one won't lose anything if you just assume E is a constant rank bundle for most bundle if dimension E is constant, dimension EY is constant. So if X is connected, for instance, then any vector bundle will have constant rank. Okay. So the first example is obviously the trivial bundle. So you take E to be X cross Cn over X. So what is the projection map? XV goes to X. That's the first projection. So this is the fibers are all isomorphic to Cn, and that is the vector space structure you give on each fiber. And it is locally trivial is also clear because the inverse image of any open set will be U cross Cn. So such a vector bundle is called a trivial bundle. And what you are saying is, I have not yet defined morphism between vector bundles, but what you are saying is, if you restrict the vector bundle U over UX, it should be a trivial bundle. Okay. And the second example is if M is a compact manifold you can define vector bundles over paracompact spaces and so on. There is no, for the definition you don't need X to be compact, but I will prove sets one only for compact, so I will assume X to be compact throughout. So the tangent bundle, which is made up of the disjoint union of tangent spaces, this is again a vector bundle over the tangent spaces, it's a real vector bundle over M. Before giving another example, let me make a definition and do an exercise. So suppose if E to X is a vector bundle, a section is a map, S from X to E such that S of X is in EX for X in X. So a section means it's a continuous, by map it's a continuous map. Section means over every point X you choose a point in the fiber. So any continuous map from X to E such that at X it should be in EX, such a thing is called a section. Okay. Because you can think of local trivialization as choosing n independent sections. So that's what it's nice to have this definition. So here is the exercise. Okay, I'll prove it. So E is a n-dimensional bundle. So n-dimensional bundle means the fibers are all of n dimension for every X. E is trivial if there exist n linearly independent sections. N sections S1, S2, Sn such that for x, this set S1x, S2x, Snx form a basis. So you can guess what I'm, so I have not yet defined morphism between vector bundles, but what do I mean by saying E is trivial is, it is isomorphic to a, E is trivial means it's isomorphic to a bundle. So this is what I mean by saying there exists a map F which is an isomorphism such that this diagram commutes. So what do I mean by saying E is trivial is, E is isomorphic to a trivial bundle, by which I mean there exists a map from E to x cross Cn such that this diagram commutes, and which is a topological isomorphism, and it's piecewise, it's linear. So okay, the proof of E is trivial if and only, yes. Okay, if E is trivial, then you can see an independent sections, right? Because a section means you have to give a map from here to here. You have to give, this is the trivial vector bundle. A section means you have to give a map from here to here. So you can define SAX to be XEI, where EI are the coordinate basis of, EIs are the standard basis for CN. And this for a, this will be a section, and all these things are linearly independent, and they will form a basis for each fiber. And if you have n linearly independent sections, then you can easily see that it is trivial, because you take any element E in E, you can express E as, if E lives over X, you can express E as summation AIE SIE, SI of X. E lives over X. So E is in, so E will be in the vector space EX, and SIX form a basis for EX. So you can express E as a linear combination of them. So you have N coordinates. So the map E going to PX, S1X, SNX, A1E, A2E, is going to form an isomorphism, is going to become an isomorphism. That's why trivial can also be expressed by saying choosing n independent sections. And local trivialization means you have to choose n local sections. So, instead of proving that it is locally trivial, sometimes it is easier to give local sections. So remark, I will write it in quotes, local trivialization means giving local sections. Okay, so what do I mean by local section? Local sections are defined only, a section is defined from, if this is a vector bundle, a section is defined from X to E. Local section is defined only on an open set from here to here. Okay, it's defined only locally. That's called a local section. And if you can give n independent local sections, the same kind of argument will give you a local trivialization. So, okay. So now let me give more examples. Let us look at P1C, which is one-dimensional subspaces of C2. PNC is one-dimensional subspaces of CN plus 1. Subspaces of Hilbert spaces can be identified with projections. So you can identify this with is it one dimensional or n dimensional?
One
only, right? It's line. Both of them will be same because you can go from P to 1 minus P. So you can it is a set of all So it's a set of all one-dimensional subspaces of n plus one-dimensional space. You've been seeing that for from last lecture. So if you have a subspace of a closed subspace of Hilbert space, you can associate to it its orthogonal projection. So you can consider one-dimensional subspaces of Cn plus 1 as equivalent to projections in Mn plus 1 C, which are projections, and trace 1. Okay, so this is how I topologize this. I mean, you can define a topology on this by using local charts and so on. But using this association, you define a topology on this. Then this will be a compact Hausdorff space. And more generally, you can define what are called Grassmannians. So this is k-dimensional subspaces of Cn, and this will be in isomorphic to set of all projections P in M and C, P square equals P star, and trace of P is K. Trace of P is K means dimension of the range of P is K. So if you take a projection P, I associate to it range of P, that will give rise to a K dimensional subspace.
Don't you want to say something about rank there? Third line from below.
Trace of P equals K.
And two lines above also.
Trace of P is one.
Rank.
That is dimension of range of
yes.
P. So.
Rank and trace the same.
For projections, yeah. So okay, this can be expressed also as saying dimension of range of P. These two are equal always. So it's we will use this identification all the time. That is not this one. So if you have a projection P, I associate it to it range of P, and that will give rise to projections on one hand, closed subspaces on a Hilbert space. So So closed subspaces of H can be identified with projections on BH. Okay. So these are called the Grassmannian. So you look at the k-dimensional subspaces of CN, and that can be identified with projections whose trace is k-dimensional projections. And there are naturally associated vector bundles over it, which so I'm going to associate a natural vector bundle. So let us define E and K is set of all, so PV. So this is same as, let me again write, which is a subset of this is the collection of all pairs WV, where W is a k-dimensional subspace and V belongs to V. So I can define this projection map PV goes to P, or so this is the projection map, and over every, this is the surjective map, and over a subspace W, the fiber is the inverse image of W, the fiber is WV, where V is in W. So over any k-dimensional subspace, its fiber is isomorphic to W itself. So is that clear? So it's over the fiber over any W is just W itself. Okay, and this can be expressed if you associate W to a projection P. The fact that V is in W, V is in range of P, is equivalent to saying PV equals V. Right? So, I mean, you have to verify that this is a vector bundle, but you have a total space, you have a base space, and you have a surjective map, and each fiber is a finite dimensional vector space, and one has to check the local triviality condition.
In your local triviality, why you didn't take the infinite universal case?
You want to study Banach manifold, the Hilbert manifold?
Hilbert C star modules. So you can take, but the Sayre-Swan theorem will be for finite dimensional only. And this example, so I have not checked the local triviality condition here, but this example is more general. So there is a more general example. So that example comes, so what you are doing, so let me write like this. It's lovely only. So for every point W, you are associating a projection with the projection P of W. So for every point W, you are having a projection, and this projection is in MN of the Grassmannian. So you are having a continuous valued projection map from Grassmannians to MNC.
MN
of C, sorry. That entire thing will be in MN of C of W going to P of W will be in MN of whatever. So for every point W, you are associating a projection M and C, and this is a continuous valued map. Because that's how you topologize the Grassmannians. Given a continuous valued projection map from X to M and C, you can associate a vector bundle. And so that is the next example. So let P from X to M and C be continuous. Be continuous such that P of X is a projection. So define E to be XV such that PXV equals V. X. I mean, I won't write the projection map, it's clear. So look at a continuous map from X to M and C, such that at every x it's a projection, then you can define a vector bundle that is a set of all pairs xv such that v is in range of px, that is expressed by saying pxv equals v. And the surjective map from e to x is xv going to x, and the fiber over x is just set of all v such that V is in range of Px. So the fiber over any point X is range of Px. Okay, this is equivalent to saying P belongs to M and C. Okay, so you can identify M and Cx with M and Cx is same as C of X M and C, and so this is same as that. Okay.
Maybe you should. That symbol they haven't been used so far.
Oh, okay.
M and of a hand is a very interesting.
Yeah, we will need it anyway. So M and of A is, if A is an algebra, M and of A is just n cross n matrices with each element is in A. With each element is in A, and you can multiply two matrices just like matrix multiplication. So MN of CX is, what is MN of CX? MN of CX is just, so if you take an element A in MN of CX, A is just a matrix Aij, but each Aij is in Cx. Each Aij is a continuous function on X. So X going to Aij X will be a matrix valued continuous function. So that is the association that I'm saying there. Okay, so we are already into one part of Says 1 theorem. So what Says 1 theorem will say is every vector bundle will come like this. Okay, so let's prove that is actually a vector bundle. and this is a sub of x cross cn, okay? And m and c acts on cn by, you think of cn as column vectors, m and c act on cn by matrix multiplication. Okay, so you will, we will see that every vector bundle will be of this form. So let's prove that this is in fact a vector bundle. I have not proved anything, any vector bundle is a vector bundle, right? So so proof we have to do. So before that, let me give an exercise. So I want to give this exercise. Suppose U is an open set in X and V1, V2, Vn, Vm, they are continuous functions from U to Cn. That is, continuous. And fix a point x0. If at x0, if these are linearly independent, then it is linearly independent. Then there exists an open set V such that x0 is in V contained in U, such that V1, V2, Vm restricted to V are also linearly independent. So I'll leave this exercise. So the thing is, if at x0, if all the, so you are associating for every point x in U a vector in Cn, and if at x0, if all of them are linearly independent, then in a neighborhood around x0, it has to be linearly independent. Okay. Okay. So we have to. So the only non-trivial thing that we have to check is the local triviality condition. So let us take a point x0 in X. We have to give n. So let's proof of, not proof of this exercise, proof of the fact that E is in fact a vector bundle. So fix a point x0. So choose a neighborhood first U. Okay, so trace of Px, let me, trace of Px is K around U, x0. So P is a continuous valued projection. So let us call K to be the trace of P at x0. Trace of Px are integer valued and it is continuous, so it has to be locally constant. So choose a neighborhood around x0 such that it is constant. Instead of writing it down, I'm writing it like this. Okay. Now look at x0 and choose vectors. Choose v1, v2, vm, vk in range of px0. So look at the fiber. So look at the fiber at x0, which is range of px0. So this is a subspace of Cn, right? So what is the fiber at x0? The fiber at x0 is just the range of the projection associated to x0. Look at the fiber at x0, and for that fiber you choose a basis. choose a basis. Choose a basis for that fiber. Then, and extend this basis to the whole of Cn. So extend V1, V2, Vm, Vk, Vk plus 1, Vn, extend to a basis for Cn. Extend this to a basis for the whole of Cn. Now define Si x to be x p of x here. Okay, so Si x to be x p of x vi for 1 less than or equals I less than or equals k. So I have to give a trivialization for E, right? So I have to give k local sections around x naught. Around x naught, each fiber has dimension k. Around x naught, the trace of p of x is assumed to be k. So around x naught, I have to give n local sections. So at x naught, you have local sections v1, v2, vk. You have a basis for range of px naught. So I'm using that basis to and hit it with p of x. These will obviously be in E, right? Because p of x vi is in range of p of x. So these will be in E. So these will be k sections. And around x naught, these will be linearly independent as well. Because at x naught they are linearly independent. And so around x naught all these vectors will be linearly independent. So these are k linearly independent sections around x naught. Therefore this vector bundle is locally trivial.
Can you say the same thing slightly differently?
Okay.
You take the matrix P of X naught, it has rank K.
Okay.
So it has K independent columns.
Yeah.
So you call those V1 X naught. So we have all those columns J1, J2, JK.
Yeah.
And then look at P sub J, the JK column of X as VK of X.
Yeah. It's the same thing I'm doing. Okay, so it's so the thing is, if you have a continuous, if you choose a set of vectors, m vectors, continuously, and if they are linearly independent at a point, then it has to be linearly independent around a point. So that's all. Okay, so this is a vector bundle over X, and we will later show that every vector bundle comes this way. That is the goal of my lecture. Okay, so now, so more operations on vector bundles. So let me erase this. Okay, before I go, let me give two exercises. So the proofs will be exercises. So let's start with the vector bundle E over X, and then you choose open sets. So X is a compact space, so you can choose finitely many open sets over which the vector bundle is trivial. So you choose trivialization, U alpha, H alpha. It's a trivializing cover for okay. So what do I mean by that is, so it's P inverse U alpha to U alpha cross Let me assume it's of constant rank, okay? So I don't have to carry the index alphas. So u alpha n so this is the map height alpha, okay, and union u alpha is x. So u alpha covers x, and over each u alpha the vector bundles are trivial, and I choose for every alpha I choose one isomorphism between P inverse u alpha and u alpha cross Cn, okay, fix an isomorphism. Now you look at them at the intersection. So look at this map, look at the intersections between any two things. So this diagram commutes and this diagram commutes. So look at the intersections and look at the maps. Then there are two maps. One is by the trivialization h alpha, another is by the trivialization h beta. So it goes this way and that this goes that way. So this diagram commutes, this diagram commutes. So if you start from here and go there, how do I go there? All of them are isomorphisms. So I can take its inverse. So you take h beta inverse and h alpha, then you will go from here to there, and the resulting diagram will also commute, because each part commutes, the resulting diagram will commute. So what is that? So look at this. Alpha beta, not G alpha beta. So let us look at height alpha beta, height beta inverse. But how this will look like? Because this diagram commutes. So if you operate height alpha, height beta inverse on a vector xv, the first coordinate has to be x itself, because it has to come down to x. The first coordinate has to be x. And the second coordinate will be depending upon x times v. So look at xv, because this diagram commutes, the first coordinate has to be x, because it has to take fiber to fiber. The fiber is xv with v in Cn, so it has to go to x, and the second coordinate will look like this. It has to be linear on v. So it has to be a linear map times V. So you have these maps, G alpha beta, X belongs to GLN. So G alpha betas are defined, so X is in U alpha intersection U beta. So this G alpha betas are defined from U alpha intersection U beta to GLNC. Because they are isomorphisms, so it has to fall in GLNC. And you can verify that. So this is usually written, we also write like this. G alpha beta, but it is not exactly H alpha H beta inverse, but so what are the, you were saying something? No. So what are the relations that it will satisfy is G alpha alpha will be identity, and G alpha beta G beta gamma will be G alpha gamma. I mean, H alpha inverse will be identity. If you take H alpha H beta inverse and H beta H gamma inverse, it has to be H alpha H gamma inverse. So this is valid only on the intersection. I mean, wherever it makes sense, it's valid. So what does this means is G alpha alpha X is identity if X is in U alpha, intersection U alpha, which is U alpha. But G alpha gamma X will make sense on U alpha intersection U gamma. So this is on U alpha intersection U beta intersection U gamma. Okay, so okay, and these functions are called the transition functions, and you can recover your vector bundle using them. So okay, so what is the exercise that I want to give? So yeah, the exercise is the following. So you fix the open sets U alpha, but choose different trivialization. Choose H alpha tilde. Then you will get different G alpha betas, right? And how they are related is by this. So fix the same open sets. U alphas, but choose different trivialization. Say H alpha tilde, then you will end up getting G alpha beta tildes. And how? What is the relation between G alpha beta tilde and G alpha beta is the following. So there exists, prove that there exists M alphas from U alpha to GLNC such that, say L alpha, such that G alpha beta is L alpha G alpha beta tilde inverse L beta inverse. Okay, so any two transition function on the same open cover is related by this thing. So over each U alpha you have a function from L alpha, from U alpha to GLNC, and they are related by this. So if you have a trivial bundle, this gives a condition on checking triviality. If you have a trivial bundle, then for some trivialization G alpha beta has to be for some trivialization G alpha beta has to be 1. So if you choose any trivialization, G alpha beta should be looking like L alpha L beta inverse. Okay, so that's another exercise. So E is trivial if and only if G alpha beta is L alpha L beta. So if your transition function looks like L alpha L beta inverse, then the vector bundle that you had started with is trivial. Okay, so and the another point is one can reconstruct E from these G alpha betas. So how one, okay, so So what we have done, so if you have started with the vector bundle and if you choose open sets U alphas and trivialization H alphas, you will end up getting functions from the intersection to GL and C which satisfies these conditions. Okay, and the now we can reverse the thing. That is, if you are given an open cover U alphas and functions from U alpha intersection from the intersection to GL and C satisfying these two conditions, we can construct another vector bundle. So we can construct a vector bundle. So a cocycle means on from intersections to GL and C you are given maps and they satisfy this condition. So you are given G alpha beta from U alpha intersection U beta to GL and C and they satisfy G alpha, alpha is identity, G alpha beta, G beta gamma is G alpha gamma. Then you can construct another vector bundle. How do you construct this?
No, what did you write on the G alpha
beta? Beta, G alpha gamma, G alpha.
Second line?
U alpha intersection U beta to GL and C. So you can construct a new vector bundle. How you can construct is you take the you take this disjoint union of U alpha cross CN and define an equivalence relation. So define this on this by you declare XV. XV in U alpha CN, I mean G alpha beta are called transition function because you should think of vector. So with X in U alpha is related with Y in YW with Y in U beta if and only if X equals Y and V equals G alpha beta XW. So you identify the vector XV with YW if they are equal first, the first coordinates, and if the vector and G alpha beta changes W to V. So now look at the equivalence class. Now define E to be gamma is the this is a vector bundle over X where XV the equivalence class XV will go to X. So what is the addition? So each element here is an equivalence class XV plus XW is just X V plus W, but this is well defined because if you apply G alpha beta X on V, they are equal, but that's a linear map. Therefore, this is well defined. This is the additive structure, and the scalar multiplicative structure is, of course, so alpha beta is alpha V plus beta. So now the exercise is prove that E is a vector bundle over X. It's a vector bundle over X. If you had started with the vector bundle E and if you had gone to G alpha, the transition functions G alpha beta and do this process, you end up getting the same bundle. So that is another exercise. So it's okay. So
what is the speciality of this? I mean, this vector.
What is the speciality means?
I mean, it started with one thing, it ended up with another.
This is isomorphic to what you have started with. given this thing, you can construct a vector bundle.
Yeah.
This is this construction. Given a vector bundle, you will end up, you will have transition functions.
Yeah.
Then you can apply this construction.
Yeah.
The point is, the new bundle that you constructed from this construction is the same as the original one. And this gives a nice way of constructing new vector bundles also. Okay. So for example, if you want to add two vector bundles, you have the transition function g alpha beta for one vector bundle, you have another transition function for another vector bundle, then you can put them along the diagonals. That will also satisfy this first cycle condition, and you will have a new thing. Okay, so I will illustrate this. So before going to define K theory, let me give an example of a real vector bundle which is non-trivial. So it's called the Mobius bundle, where you will see these exercises. You will see handling with it's over S1 a real bundle. Okay, so you take 0, 1 × R as your space, and then you identify. So it's easy to draw a picture. 0T is identified with 1 − T. So you have this. This is x equal to 0, x equals 1. This is the thing. So this point is identified with this point. 0T is identified with 1 − T, and nothing else is identified. So this point will be identified with this point. Okay, because 0, 0 will be identified with 1, 0. This point gets identified with this point. So this will be the equivalence class. So define E to be 0, 1 × R by this, and this will be a real bundle over S1. So if you identify this with this, this gets wrapped up, and so that will give rise to a circle. And the fiber over any point is R. So that is your bundle over S1. Okay, so. And if you write down the transition functions, so let me choose open sets like this. So this is U. So your base space is this line with endpoints identified. So you choose this open set U, choose this as another open set V. Okay, so I mean I'm not going to explain why this is a vector bundle in the first place, but I'll show you why this is a non-trivial bundle. So this picture is the base space is circle with this point and this point identified, so that is your base space. So I'm taking open sets which cover the base space. So one open set is this together with that. That will cover the endpoints. And another open set is this V. Okay. Now, if you write down the transition function, what you will end up getting is, so, uh, So all the fibers are one dimensional, it's all isomorphic to R. So one dimensional thing, linear isomorphisms are given by multiplication by some number. So if you write down the transition function so G, U, V, so there is only one transition function, right? There are two sets U and V. The transition functions G, U, U will be identity, G, V, V will be identity, and you have to define what is G, U, V. On the intersection you have to say what it is. So this is 1 if X is, so the intersection is this part. If X is, I don't know how to write this, so left part and right part, and minus 1 if X is in right part. Okay, so this I'm not going to prove, but you can so the transition function, if you write down, it will be like that. Or if you want to exhibit a non-trivial bundle, take this as transition function and construct a bundle using the previous construction. And why is this a non-trivial bundle? Because if it were a trivial bundle, then the transition function should look like L alpha L beta inverse. So but for one dimensional thing, what does that mean? That means G U V has to be of the form L U X by L V X, where L U is defined from U to, so let me write 1 and okay, L U is defined from U to R star, and L V is defined from V to R star. Right? Because if it were trivial, then G U V has to have this form. But G U V can't have this form because the set U, both U and V are connected sets. U is connected. This point is identified with this point. That's what U is connected, and V is also connected. So LU has to have constant sign and LV has to have constant sign. If it has to be either positive or it has to be negative. So the fraction will also have constant sign on the intersection, but you have different signs on the intersection. That's why this is a non-trivial bundle. Okay. Still I have 10 more times. So let me define how to add vector bundles and then I will stop. So Whitney sum and pullback. So if we start with two vector bundles over X, they are vector bundles over X. I'm not right. For E it is P and okay. For E it is P and for X it is Q. Define E plus F to be. Over every fiber, you take the fiber of X and fiber of F and add them. So it is EF such that PE equals QF. And the surjective map from E plus F to X is, as you can say, it's EF going to PE or QF. Both of them go to the same point. So over X, the fiber is just EX plus FX. So this will be a vector bundle. So, and you can see that the transition functions, if you write down the transition function, if G alpha beta is the transition function for functions for E, and H alpha beta is that are the transition functions for F. Then the transition function for E plus F will be G alpha beta 0 0 H alpha beta. So I mean, you choose the same open cover and trivialize them. So this will be a vector bundle over X, and this is called the Whitney sum of E and F. And this is clearly commutative, right? EF going to FE will be an isomorphism. And so this is up to isomorphism, this operation addition is commutative. So the note is up to isomorphism. This is commutative. Okay. Another thing that I want is pull back. So suppose you have a map from Y to X and a vector bundle over X. I can pull back this vector bundle over Y. So that is defined as follows. So it is set of all Y E such that F of Y equals P of. And this is a bundle over Y with Y E going to E. Okay, so vector bundles over X can be pulled back to vector bundles over Y if you are given map from Y to X. Okay, so what do we have? So we have a addition operation among vector bundles. You can add two vector bundles, and this is also associative up to isomorphism. So let me look at the isomorphism classes of vector bundles over X with the so let's call this as Vx. So take all vector bundles over X, but identify if both of them are, if two of them are isomorphic. Consider this set of all isomorphism class of vector bundles over X. Then you have an plus is a commutative. So you have an operation plus on Vx. And so the thing is Vx plus is an abelian semigroup. With zero. So what is the zero element? The zero element is the zero vector bundle where each fiber has zero dimension. So this is, you are adding fiber wise the addition. So if you add the zero dimensional vector bundle, you are going to end up with the same vector bundle. So this is an abelian semigroup with zero, and you can always construct a group out of an abelian semigroup with zero. So that is called the Grothendieck construction. So I'll just give a preview of what we'll do next time. So Grothendieck construction will give rise to, from this you can apply Grothendieck construction and end up getting an abelian group. This is a genuine abelian group. I mean, this cannot be a group at all, right? Because if you start with the non, if you start with a vector bundle where the fibers have non-zero dimension, then you can't add anything and get zero dimension. So this is never going to be a group. It's only an abelian semigroup with zero. But you can always construct a group from an abelian semigroup with zero, and that construction is called Grothendieck construction. This is exactly similar to how we construct integers from natural numbers. Natural numbers is just a group, is just an abelian semigroup with zero. It does not have inverse, and but you put an equivalence relation and construct integers out of it. It's the same thing, and you end up getting an abelian group, and this group is called the K theory of X, and this is called the topological K theory. Do we have time? Can I take 5 minutes to explain this Grothendieck construction? Can, okay. How do I? No, I want to. I was thinking whether to explain this or not. I mean, I will explain the Grothendieck construction, but I was thinking whether I have the time or not. I'll explain the Grothendieck construction and stop. So let me explain the Grothendieck construction and stop. So Grothendieck construction is for, you can start with any abelian semigroup with zero and get a group. That is the Grothendieck construction. So this is exactly similar to how we construct integers from natural numbers. So let us start with R plus is an abelian semigroup. With zero. You don't have to have zero to do this, but if R does, if it does not have zero, you can always throw in zero. You can add one more element and declare that to be zero. Then you look at R cross R. You think that is, you look at XY, but if you think of XY as, XY should be thought of as, not XY, AB, right? AB should be thought of as, should be equal, A minus. So this is how you construct integers from natural numbers, right? So define AB to be equivalent to CD if there exists E. So A minus B should be equal to C minus D. A minus B should be thought of as A minus B, and C D should be thought of as C minus D. They should be equal. So A plus D should be equal to B plus C. But then the abelian semigroup that you start with, so this is the correct equivalence relation you should define. There exists E in R such that A plus D plus E equals B plus C plus D. So it's not just A plus D equals B plus C, but after adding some element E, they have to be same. Then only you will see that this is an equivalence relation. This is an equivalence relation only if you add this. If you simply define A plus D equals B plus C, then to check that whether it is transitive, you need to cancel out some parts. But R may not be a cancellative semigroup, so it may, so that relation, so you have to add this one more E. So check that E is, check that this is an equivalence relation. And let us define this G of R to be R cross R, the equivalence classes of AB. And that is the Grothendieck group associated to R. And how is the addition operation defined here? The addition operation is defined simply, the addition operation A plus B, this is an equivalence class containing A plus B, and this should be thought of as A minus B. So you are adding A minus B with C minus D. So it should be A plus C and B plus D. So the addition is defined by this expression, and you have to check that this is well defined. And the inverse of the negative of AB will be, this is A minus B, so the inverse has to be B minus A, it is BA. And the 0 is simply 0. So G of R, so exercise, prove that G of R is a group. So starting with any abelian semigroup with 0, using this construction you can get a abelian group. So you start with the set of isomorphism class of vector bundles over X. The Whitney sum addition will give rise to an abelian semigroup with 0. Now apply this construction and end up getting a group, and this is called the K group of X. So I'll stop here. Any questions?
you want to take a problem session, a tutorial session, you want to maybe answer some of these things there.
Okay. Huh? Okay, I can take it. Yeah.
Okay, so.
So if.
Will you
I won't be.
Tomorrow or?
But I don't want to lecture on the tutorial session. I will.
Yeah, so just ask people to.
Okay. Sure.
Maybe you can. Do you have any notes?
I will give the, but it will be sort of exercise, so I will give that notes.
Yeah, if you give that, then you can just post it on this page.
Yeah, sure, I will forward
it. People can look at it and then.
Yeah, sure.
Then maybe tomorrow they can think about it. Today,
okay,
I'll harass them.
Okay.